Hello and welcome to what's this now? Episode number three. So we've done some basic stuff so far. So we've done a bit of a hello world over serial over the logging terminal, and we've done Blink as well. So I think let's sort of explore one of the unique things that the ESP can do that a lot of other chips can't. Which of course, well, one of which is of course Wi-Fi. Unlikely to get all this done in one episode. I don't know. We'll see how I'm feeling. I'm not feeling 100% at the moment, but I've had quite a bit of interest in this series, so I want to give you guys some good content. I don't want to make it for the sake of it, but anyway, that's enough waffle. Let's start digging in. So here we've got our project from last time. I'm leaving it exactly as it is. This will ultimately go up onto GitHub when I pull my finger out. And in the description of the video, I'll put a link to the specific commit ID of where that video sort of started from. So you can go through at your own pace and you can actually see where we got to. But the head of that repository that I'll make public and everything will be as it is at that point, working point in time. So to do Wi-Fi stuff, first of all, we've got to do a couple of bits of housekeeping on the chip. As I said, leaving the Blink stuff and the Hello World in, that's staying on. We won't actually be looking at the chip on the webcam today. Well, I've taken the LED off, but anyway, that code's still running, just sort of proves it's going. The housekeeping stuff, really, you need to do anyway on the ESP, and there's two particular functions that you need to call. My preferred way of calling these two functions is in this app main before your user main actually starts and does anything. I have tried doing it in my setup, you know, in this my main.setup. Works fine in there, but personally I just think it's easier to sort of see what's going on. But anyway, like everything in code, there's a million and one ways of doing it. In this instance, there's probably no wrong or right way. Well, there's probably is wrong ways of doing it, but hey, this isn't a wrong way. So the first function we need to call is ESP event, oops, event loop create default, and I'm gonna try and get in the habit of using the autocomplete so you don't have to hear me smashing the keyboard quite so much. We'll get into the event loops and I'll explain a little bit more about what they are when we come to do the Wi-Fi stuff a little bit later on. But it's effectively a notification system, so it allows one bit of the code, a task, to communicate some sort of useful information to another task. And the ESP has a default event loop, or a system event loop, if you were to give it a more sort of Windowsy type, Unixy type name, I guess. And this just sets all of that up and makes sure it exists. So when we start you or including the Wi-Fi stuff from the IDF that works behind the scenes, it's actually got that event loop. It actually exists. So when it's doing its thing and posting to that event loop, you don't get a hard fault or a seg fault if you prefer, memory access violation, because that event loop doesn't exist. That could be things like I've connected to the Wi-Fi, I've got an IP address, and we'll see that a bit later on. So that's pretty much the first thing that's going to happen in my user code is we'll create this event loop. Now, does this return an error type? Yes, it does. So we can do an error check on this. I must say, I'm not a huge fan of this macro, but we'll do it. And like we explained last time, all this macro does, ESP error check, is if this function returns anything other than ESP OK, which is that yes, everything is fine, then it will cause the system to abort. It will call the abort method or function, which basically reboots the chip, and the chip will just be sat rebooting itself over and over again because it's the first thing that happens. In this case, it's probably quite valid to use this, because if that doesn't get created, then we've got bigger issues and we don't really want the user code running anyway. So it's something we'd want to pick up. In a similar vein to sort of memory and initialization and whatever, we also need to initialize the non-volatile store. So the ESP has an interesting memory structure, having done quite a lot recently with the STM32s. That's primarily what I work on for my day job. We have unified memory, which is basically, if you don't know what that is, imagine the memory on the processor as a single USB stick. It's one big chunk of memory, and you can format it however you like. So you can use some of it to store your program code and your processor operations and so on and so forth. You can use part of it as RAM. You can use part of it for your static data stores, and various other bits and bobs. And you can obviously use the rest of it as heap memory if you choose to do so. It's unified memory, it's one contiguous block. The ESP is slightly different. It actually has lots of different chunks of memory that have all got different capabilities, but the main bulk of it that we use sort of on think of a good way of explaining this. Let's keep it simple, but bearing in mind I am oversimplifying this. The main chunk of it is not actually on the chip itself. It's still within the metal can that sits on top of the WROM or the WROVER modules, for example, but it's actually a separate flash chip, and it is just purely a memory chip. And that's where your user code gets stored, and we can also use it for heap and stack and so on and so forth. Comes with its disadvantages because it's not on the chip itself, then we have to use the SPI bus to get data or instructions to and from it, which can be slow. So you'll see when you go into the menu config, you can select different SPI flash modes like DIO and QIO and things like that. That's basically different. The wiki article on QIO is quite good, actually. It sort of explains how they manipulate the bus to get four times the data rate. Hence quad IO, quad meaning four. So you get four times the data rate. So it reduces that hit. Anyway, a lot of the NVS is stored in the SPI flash. In fact, I think all of it is, but don't quote me on that. And the Wi-Fi uses this to store various bits and bobs. For example, its power setting. So whether you've got it in a power save mode and so on and so forth. It also does some funky stuff under the hood that we don't really have access to unless you dig for calibrating the power of the power amplifier, which is what's connected to the antenna to push out your data, and pull in your data actually as well over Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, and Bluetooth low energy as well. For Wi-Fi, BLE, various bits and bobs to work, the flash needs to be initialized. Now, you could say that, well, because it's a dependency of Wi-Fi, when we come to write our Wi-Fi class, we should initialize it in there. Valid argument, and I did actually do that a while ago, and then I came to need to use Bluetooth, which also requires the NVS flash to be initialized. So I was initializing it in there. Ha! Crash. Can't initialize it twice. More annoyingly, you can't see if it has already been initialized. There's no method or function call to check whether it has been initialized. At least not last time I looked. Similarly, you can't do it for the UARTs as well, which is a bit annoying. I did actually put a GitHub issue, well, feature request, should I say, to do that, because that would be quite handy. So therefore, this NVS initialization needs to be done at a higher level rather than at the component level, or it makes more sense to do it there. And quite simply, the call is NVS flash init. I could have probably typed it in that time. And let's have a look. Does this one return an error type? Yes, it does. So again, we can use our macro. If the flash init fails, if you look in the docs, the most well, there's two reasons why this could fail, but the most likely is that there are no free pages, in which case you need to change your partition config. Using their recommended size for the NVS partition, which is what I've currently got. In fact, I don't even think we have configured our partitions. No, we have not, so we're going with whatever the default is. I've never actually seen an issue, but maybe it'll happen. So that does your basic housekeeping, and largely now, this function, this app main, is now unlikely to need any further changes. The only things we could potentially add in are a log I, the log information, log tag, if you remember, is just main. And we can put a useful message in here, default event loop. Just so we can see if our chip starts rebooting in a boot loop, we can see what point it got up to. There's no guarantee that these get flushed. Not entirely sure on that. So there is a chance that this message will get printed, this function will succeed, this message will get printed, this message will fail, then the buffer gets flushed, this message gets shown up on your screen, and then this fails before this is actually put out over the serial port. Yeah, I'm not sure where the flushing happens. It's the equivalent, if you've seen other C++ stuff, of doing the standard C out, blah, which just publishes it to the buffer, and then it gets flushed when it gets flushed. But if you want to force it out at this point in time, you can use standard end line. Or you can do a standard flush or something. I forget what the actual call is. Don't use that after everything without knowing what it's doing, because it's not an optimal way of doing it. If your code, you know, if that's not relevant to you, you don't care, then well, fine, whatever. But you know, good practice is good practice. Jason Turner, who does the C++ weekly videos, fantastic, very opinionated. I agree with a lot of what he says, some things I don't, but that's the beauty of the whole thing, is you can, you know, you can see how other people do it and pick up best practices, and then you know, roll your own, as it were. So initializing NVS. Yes, I am British. Hence, that's an S. Yeah, right. App main Need not change now. Forevermore. Cool. Save. Done. Forgotten about. So let's have a look at the Wi-Fi. Now, we want to understand what we're trying to achieve here. And it's always good practice. In fact, this is one thing I would absolutely say you must do, if I'm going to impart any knowledge on you, is draw a picture, draw a diagram, do something. Pen and paper is normally the easiest to scribble things down. Hence, I'm not going to be able to show this because I haven't got a setup at the moment to show you my scribblings on paper, and I'm an engineer, so there's not a chance in hell you'd be able to read my writing anyway. But you want to think of the highest possible level. What is it you want to achieve? Don't start go looking through the API and figuring out what function calls you need to make and so on and so forth. That's for the next step. Think about what we're trying to do here. This is called the top-down method. So let's talk a little bit about that. What do we want to achieve? Well, quite simply, we want a stable Wi-Fi connection that can be configured by the user, not necessarily through code. So imagine we are giving this device to someone. So ultimately our ESP could have a load of sensors on it. We can just build and flash our Wi-Fi credentials in there and hard code it. That's fine, that's not a problem for us. If we're giving it to someone else, we don't want to have to ask them what their Wi-Fi password and username and their subnet masks and all that. It's not good for them to tell you because security and all the rest of it, but equally it's a faff. It's an absolute faff, and then, you know, someone else wants it, you give it to them, and then all of a sudden you've got to have lots of different compile flags, depending on who it is you're giving it to set the right username and password. And then, of course, you do an update to fix a bug or add a new feature, and then you've got to, you can see where this is going. That would be a pain in the butt. So, needs to be easily configurable by the dumb user who doesn't have access to VS Code, the IDF, build tools, a USB cable, so on and so forth. What do I mean by it's got to be stable? Well, that's quite an easy one to describe. If the Wi-Fi drops, it has to reconnect by itself with no user intervention. Now, this is quite an interesting case because if you look at why Wi-Fi might disconnect, there's actually several different reasons for it. Could be as simple as the range. You're on the edge of the range, so it's sort of come in and go in on the wind. It could be someone turned a microwave on. Microwaves typically operate around 2.4 gigahertz and they tend to nuke Wi-Fi signals and Bluetooth. So it just causes the noise floor to rise, and therefore you can't distinguish the chip can't distinguish the Wi-Fi signal from the noise. It could be that your router is set to reboot every night. Mine reboots in the depths of night every day. Just good practice, and since I set that up many years ago, my Wi-Fi never drops out. It's good. Or it could be that you're doing it to a hotspot on your phone and your hotspot's not always on, but you might want to turn the hotspot on for 5 minutes just to do some sort of connection or configuring and then turn the hotspot off. The ESP will then just continually look to see if there's a hotspot, not crash, not get into, you know, a horrendous boot loop, but it'll be happy but on limited functionality, and then when that hotspot pops up again, it'll go, ooh, it's there, connect, do the things, and so on. All Wi-Fi could drop out for a software / firmware type issue, your code's crashed or lagged For example, you took up too much processor time, so some timings went awry in the Wi-Fi backend. Many, many things. And that's pretty much all we want, certainly at this stage from the Wi-Fi. The only other thing I would potentially add in, in fact, I will add in, is some sort of way of messaging. So we might have other components running that may depend on Wi-Fi, and their state may need to change depending on whether we have or have not got a Wi-Fi connection. Strictly talking about Wi-Fi network connection here, not necessarily an internet connection. So we might want some sort of messaging system. So for example, MQTT, you might be familiar with MQTT. It's basically a text-based messaging system that's network-based. So can be through IP, through the internet, can be local on your network. That may have to change its state depending on whether or not the network exists. So if the network does exist, then MQTT may look for the server and be able to serve and receive messages. If Wi-Fi is not connected, then there's no point at trying to look for the server. It might cause the code to crash. For example, trying to send out messages over over the network. Some sort of messaging system would be handy. I suppose the last thing I will lump in, just looking at my notes here, is the MAC address. I always forget what that stands for. Anyway, the MAC address, well, the ESP has several, but the base MAC address is guaranteed by Espressif to be unique between ESP32 chips. So no two leave the factory with the same MAC address. Or some. There's some more words around that anyway. So that means the MAC address can be quite handy as a unique identifier, and we can read that in our code. And for example, in my MQTT messages, I use that MAC address in the device topic because only that device and no others that I flash on my network will have that topic. So it's a unique identifier. And it sort of makes sense for that to sit within the Wi-Fi class because most things that are going to care about that needing that unique identifier are going to be things that need to distinguish it from other ESPs. And the only reason for doing that, or not the only, but the most likely reason for doing that, is because there are other ESPs connected, i.e., through some sort of network. Bluetooth as well to an extent, but Bluetooth will be much later down the line. It's a bit more complex. So that's enough sort of chit chat, I think. The next thing we do need to look at, though, is okay, we've got an idea of what we want to do. Let's look at what we've got available to us. So what does the API, what does the IDF give us that allows us to do the things around Wi-Fi? And there's two sort of main bits to this. There's the actual Wi-Fi itself, and there's function calls, for example, ESP Wi-Fi set config. We can register some event handlers. We'll talk a bit about them later. And there's things like connect. So nothing sort of out of the ordinary there. All seems pretty sensible type stuff. There's other bits around the net interface, which we'll talk about when we get to it. But a lot of that, you follow the example code on their GitHub, and a lot of it's pretty much a copy and paste exercise. Excuse me, I'm really thirsty today. The other sort of biggie is the mode we're going to operate in. So we can either operate as a station, so that will connect to your router, so to your home network, or the other, well, the other two, I suppose, we can actually be an access point. So the ESP will serve as a router, or it would do if you code it to do that. So basically it pops up as a hotspot that you can connect to. That might be useful. We won't explore that, mainly because I've not done it myself, so I'm not confident around it, and I wouldn't want to present something I'm not confident in. And the other one is the mesh side of things. Now, I've not played with mesh yet. It is something I would like to do, but I, at the moment, don't have a need for it. So maybe before this series ends, we might get there. We'll see. The other big avenue when it comes to Wi-Fi is not actually in the Wi-Fi component provided by the IDF. There's a separate bit called Smart Config, and I've used this quite extensively. It has its hiccups, but on the whole, it actually works pretty darn well. And all it is a couple of function calls, and that's it. And it effectively sets the ESP up as a hotspot, although you don't really see that. But you use an app on your phone, you key in your Wi-Fi password, it detects what Wi-Fi you're on your phone, and then it sends it over some weird type protocol. You can look into it. It's quite interesting how they do it. It's clever. But anyway, and it appears on the ESP, and then the ESP can use that password and SSID of your network to then pass on to the Wi-Fi and say, right, this is your credentials you need to connect. We will be using that. Saves a lot of headache. And from the user's point of view, all you need is an app on your phone. You don't need to be able to flash the device and hard code in passwords and things, which if you're uploading stuff to GitHub, you know, you don't want to be putting your network password and so on. There's other ways around it, but you know, this is an easy one. The downside, though, when you read through the smart config stuff and the Wi-Fi stuff, is it does not save those credentials to this non-volatile memory. So each time the chip reboots, whether intentionally or otherwise, you then have to go through the smart config process. So we will, at some point, probably after we've done this, need to set up some non-volatile memory so that we can save those credentials. So once they're entered, jobs are good, and we can reboot the chip, but it will remember which network it should be connecting to. And of course, we can add some fallbacks into that in case we actually do want to change it. So, you know, we change our provider at home or our router or whatever, or you key it in wrong, or your password changes or whatever. So we've got a reasonable idea of what's going on. Let's get into it. So let's create a component. I'm going to call it Wi-Fi. And we know the basic stuff we need to stick in here. We've got our little reference from the last thing we did. So we're going to do a C make lists.txt, which will allow CMake to see this component. We're going to need a Wi-Fi, and we're going to need a Wi-Fi CPP. Let's do our CMake lists first. Normally I would do this at the end, but if we remember, we declare a variable called sources, and then we can pass the sources to there. Again, you don't necessarily need to do this. You could just do that, and then you don't need this line at all. But as you'll see, when we get into more complex components, it just tidies up. It makes it look a little neater. So let's take the easy method, copy paste. It's not GPIO, it's going to be with Wi-Fi. Include DIRS yet? We'll just include the folder we're in for now. But we're going to have some requires. And the first one is going to be the SP Wi-Fi component from the IDF. The Wi-Fi itself needs the non-volatile flash. That's for its internal stuff. That doesn't include your password and whatever. So we'll include that. We said we wanted some sort of messaging type system to tell us whether or not we're connected and got an IP address or whether we've lost an IP address on. So we'll use the ESP event, oops, component there. And the last two things we're going to include are the way the IDF has been set up to do networking. The big one is the NETIF, NETs interface. And the other one, not actually expressive at all, but it's the lightweight IP library, I think is the right word. But that's very handy and very, very useful. So we'll have that in, and hopefully we don't need anything else. So we can pretty much forget about this CMake lists file now. Okay, back to my notes. Alrighty then. So in the Wi-Fi.h, let's make ourselves a namespace. No, first of all, let's do our pragma once or our define guards if you prefer doing that. Then we'll do a namespace. I'll say I do like using namespaces for things. Not strictly necessary, but good process practice, particularly if you come on to doing larger projects, just stops a bit of name collision. Although you could argue, well, write your code better so you don't get it, but and then we're going to have ourselves a class. Excellent. Now, how do I want to do this? There are. Okay, yeah, cool. Right. There are going to Let's just make everything public for now. There are going to be some standard functions or methods that we're going to need to call to get everything going. Or this is the way at least I like to do it. We'll stick with the usual error system. There's going to be an init. We'll just make it take no parameters for now. And we might also have a Go Arduino style, a begin. And the idea behind these is set everything up. Oops. And start Wi-Fi, connect, etc. Squiggly lines under the error type because we've not included that header. So we will take, can't remember which one it's actually in, but we're probably gonna get it from something. So we'll come back to that. the things we're going to need to include, well, the obvious one is, again, taking this from the example, ESP Wi-Fi dot H. And we'll just stick to that for the moment. And yes, that did have a an include along it within this to get us these. There's an argument for you still should do it, but anyway. Dependencies and the like, but given I'm so zoomed in, let's try and keep this a little bit clean and cut a couple of corners, eh? And then we might also want to know what sort of state we're in. Don't know what the type of this will be yet, but let's have it as a getter, get state. And that could be along the lines of, you know, initialized, not initialized, connected, got an IP address, lost an IP address, that sort of thing. But we don't have this type yet, so let's make it, and we'll do it as an enum. And because the enum number will be meaningless in this case, it makes sense to have it as a strongly typed enum, so an enum class in this case. My personal preference, underscore e, there's a good reason why you shouldn't do that with conventions, but hey, this is small demo code, so it's fine for this. So it's a strongly typed enum because it doesn't necessarily matter whether the word we're going to put in here is 0, 1, 2, 3 or whatever. That the number is meaningless, it's the word that means something to us. So the base state is going to be not initialized. And then initialized makes sense to be the next one. We can have a waiting for credentials, i.e. we're all ready, but we haven't got an SSID and password yet. We can have a ready to connect, i.e. we have credentials and we are ready to try an attempt to connect to that network. Nothing to say that that network exists or the credentials are correct yet. And then we can be in the state where we're actually trying to connect. There's a little bit of an in-between state here where there's a point in time where you are actually connected to the network, but you haven't been assigned an IP address yet by the DHCP server. So we'll add that in. Waiting for an IP. Connected, disconnected. And an error potentially. These might change, right? But this sort of gets us going. And what it does mean is we can finish this declaration. Sorry, definition. Okay, good. Now, this is all now starting to point towards the way this code is going to go. We've got these sequential states where we're going to move from one to the other to the other to the other in a nice, hopefully linear way, but that's the intended flow. Then this is really sort of crying out for a state machine. And a state machine is sort of exactly that. It's where if we're in this state, do something. If we're in this one, do something else. If we're in this one, do something else, and so on and so forth. Oh, you can't see my cursor. Never tweaked that. I thought you could. Ah, there we go. So this is crying out for some sort of state machine. Oh, the nag cap's on the whole time. How annoying. There we are. Now, this state machine, it makes no sense for anyone else to be calling this. It's going to be an internal machine. So we're going to make this private. Good. So we've got some basics here. Oh, we did say we would want to potentially get the MAC address. Now the way the MAC address comes from the IDF is as a char star, which is guaranteed to be a null terminated no, it's not. I'm chatting rubbish. It comes through as a byte array, I think, or a UINT32. We're probably only ever going to want it as a char star, though, or as a standard string. Char star's a little bit more lightweight, so we'll go with that. Oops. So const char star get MAC. There we go. Let me have a quick scroll through here. That looks like we've got everything we need at this moment. Yes, it does. Good, okay. So, let's save that. Let's go over to the implementation then. So we're going to need to include Wi-Fi.h first of all, and we're going to need to go into our namespace. Something like that. Now let's do the easy one first, so we've got something in here and get the ball a rolling. Yeah, let's do that. So let's do the get MAC one first. So we'll copy this definition into there and we'll stick the scope on. There we are. So this is going to be our method to get the MAC address. Now, the way I'm going to do this isn't optimal, but the number of instructions it takes isn't going to be a disaster because we're not going to be calling this rapidly. Well, unlikely to be calling this rapidly because the data, underlying data, is unlikely to change. Let's go easy mode. So we're going to make a static buffer. That is going to be a char star. Ooh, excuse me. Sorry, not char star. That is going to be of some sort of length. Don't know yet. We will do very shortly. Now the method, the function that we need to call from the IDF is, there's actually a couple, but the one I'm going to use is get default. And that will get us the MAC address from the IDF. Now this requires a parameter. a uintate star, and it's that uintate star, which is a byte buffer in this case, and it's going to put the MAC address into that buffer. So I'm already seeing a problem with the way I'm doing this, but anyway, MAC address something like that. Sorry, MAC, let's call it the raw MAC address. Let's be a bit more verbose. Always give your variables useful names, don't just call them X and Y and so on. It's you'll find out the hard way when you try and read your own code or someone else's when it's not given a good name. Now this also returns an error type, so we might want to capture that. And do something like this. And actually, might as well do brace initialization, since that's what we're sort of edging towards. Am I going to get it all on one screen? Not very easily, but hopefully you can see enough of that. I wouldn't normally drop this down a line. It's purely to get, because this zoom level. Let me know, by the way, down in the doobly-doo. In the comments as to whether or not this zoom level is sufficient for you to see it on the device you're reading it on, you're watching this on. I know I watch a lot of YouTube on Chromecasts and whenever to the TV. helps send you to sleep when you're watching telly in bed. Watch some coding, you'll be right off. But you can never blooming read it on a TV, so I'm sort of taking pointers from that. That's why I've gone to this nut zoom level. So if you're actually watching this on your PC, it might look as bad as it does to me. I guess on a phone, maybe not so much. So that's going to populate our byte buffer with some data, which is the MAC address. And if we look at the API guide on the Espressif website, we can see that that needs to be of length 6. We will initialize this byte buffer to, that's equivalent to doing that or that. Sorry, not that. Oh no, I was right the first time. Or if you see, like that. It's all the same. So default initialization. Basically, all that does is it's going to create 6 bytes on the stack, or allocate 6 bytes on the stack, and set each one of those bytes to 0. That's going to be quite handy. It's going to be more handy for this. So we're going to definitely want to do it for that, because we're going to guarantee that this is a null terminated string. If it wasn't, it's going to, you know, when you try and read that or print it out as a string, if it's not null terminated, it's just going to keep on going through your memory and, yeah, huge, huge issues. Awesome. Now we need to convert this MAC address into a string. A C string, should I say, not a C++ standard string. So a C string, keep everything nice and lightweight. And we can use sprintf for this. And actually, I'm going to use snprintf. A little bit more heavyweight, but it guarantees that the string will be terminated and not overrun, so it will not go beyond the end of the buffer. The main thing really on this that I particularly like is it gives you slightly nicer warning messages, compiler warning or error messages, if you get your buffer length wrong because you forget to add one for the null character at the end, the null terminator at the end of the string. This is going to go into Mac that we're assigning here. I'll explain why it's static in a minute. The next parameter, as you see highlighted here, is the size of this. So it's whatever these two question marks will be. So we might as well just use size of. That will just get compiled down to a number. Next one is the format. So this is what we want this string to look like. And I want this to be in hex for the MAC address, because that is typically how MAC addresses are written. But I'm not going to bother with the colons that you get to separate the, are they nibbles or bytes? I don't know. Anyway, it's just going to be a string of characters, but not with the semicolons in. Just how I'm choosing to do it. Now, how we print a hex from a byte. So a byte is going to be two hex characters. So percent means something's going to get inserted here. It's going to be two characters, and we want it to be hex, which we can use lowercase x if we want it to be lowercase hex, or we can use uppercase to be uppercase. So say your hex was AA, it would show as AA, or if we used uppercase X, it would show as AA like that. That is one byte's worth. I'm going to add a zero into there just so it null pads with zeros. That basically guarantees that two characters will be printed here. So for example, if we had hex that was 0f in the address, then it would get truncated to just f, and we would not have enough characters in our MAC address. So by adding the zero, it means here, it's not putting a zero there, it's saying if something would get truncated, because it's null, just all zeros, then don't truncate it, put a zero in instead, character zero. Have a look on the C++ reference or your guide of choice. And we need one of these for each byte. We've got six bytes, so we're just going to go copy 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Yes, that's gone off the screen, so I'm just going to tab in here. Oops, did I stick a comma? Yes, I did. Tell you what, let's just go back. Let's do comma, enter. There we go. This is the dot, 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 the ellipsis. So this is your VARGs. What's the word? Optional parameters, I forget what the word is. But anyway, this is the data that is going to be put in wherever there was a percent symbol, and then the definition of what we want. So the first thing we want to go in is going to be the first byte. So it's going to be MAC byte buffer and the first byte. And then the next one, so that one here is, strangely, going to be that one. 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 4, 3, 2. So that's our six bytes. Remember, always starting at zero when we're talking about programming. So this is a six byte buffer starting at zero. There's byte 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. If you can't get your head around that, then unlucky, you're going to have to suffer. You must. So that's going to take this first number that is a byte and convert it into its hexadecimal two-character ASCII representation. And what do we want to return? We just want to return that char star, which is MAC. Now, why have I put that word there, static, If you know what static means, great. Skip forward a minute. Not hang about. That the way it is here is a problem. And I'll tell you for why when I very quickly just fill something in. I've realized I've not done. Bear with me, troops. Just searching my notes. 13, that's it. So the length of this is 13. Oh, yeah, of course it is. 6 bytes. 2 characters per byte is 12. And then the null character at the end to denote the end of the string. So this buffer needs to be 13 bytes long. If it's not, if we get this too small, then when we try and compile this, we'll get an error because we've used snprintf. Quite handy for that. If we've made it too big, we won't get an error because it fits in the buffer and all is fine. We're just wasting a bit of memory. So what's this function doing? It's allocating on the stack within the scope of this function 13 characters. Then it's going to allocate 6 bytes. Characters and bytes are actually the same thing, but the way we use them in the code is different, but actually in the hardware it's identical. It's just 8 bits. Then we're going to get the MAC address and we're going to do a bit of formatting and put that MAC address into here. So this will ultimately look like what our MAC address might be. A, B, C, D, E, F, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And that is our 6-byte MAC address. Remember, 2 characters per byte, or 1 character per nibble if you prefer. So there's 1, there's 2, there's 3, 4, 5, 6. And then the last character is the special one, is, no, I am right, it's backslash, is the null character, but that's added in for you by snprintf. And sprintf will do the same if it's got enough space in the buffer to do it. In fact, regardless, it'll do it anyway because it doesn't, sprintf doesn't know how big the buffer is, so it'll start writing to memory it shouldn't. So that's effectively what will be in, assuming that's our MAC address, after this function call. Then we're going to return MAC, which is a const char star, so we're going to make it const, which we can do, it's only a coding thing. And it's a char star, which is effectively what this is anyway. An array is just a pointer. That's what it effectively compiles down to, but it has memory allocated to it already on the stack. Then, so we return this, we then leave the scope of this function, because we're now coming out of the curly brace. Any destruction will happen. So anything we allocated on the stack in this function now gets destroyed. So that gets destroyed, that gets destroyed. And then we jump back up to whatever called this function. That's the problem. That's the big problem. Because now the function that called this, that got the MAC address, is going to try and read this MAC address and print it to your log file. But we've just destroyed this memory. There's a very good chance it'll still exist because it doesn't get overwritten by anything when it gets destroyed. It just gets deallocated, is the loose way of thinking about it. Slightly different for the stack versus the heap, anyway. But something could overwrite this and change it. You know, there could be another function call. That then allocates more memory on the stack and it just goes over, it tramples over the top of where this was allocated because this doesn't exist anymore. If we're lucky, it does exist, but still absolutely not what you want to do, because then the function that called this is accessing memory that technically you should think of it as doesn't exist anymore. It's been not freed, but it's been deallocated. It's been made non-existent anymore, unused, and is free to be used by something else. That's a problem. And compilers may or may not tell you that. So how do we get around this? Well, the easy, quick way is make this static. Oh, come on, caps lock. Third time's a charm. What that means is that chunk of memory allocated in this call does not get destroyed. So the next time that this method gets called, this line gets skipped altogether. And whenever we refer to Mac, so down here for example, it will refer to when this was initialized. So that point in memory that has not been destroyed because it's static gets created the first time this method gets called, but then never gets destroyed within reason. So that's the easy way of doing it. There's a bit of an overhead that goes with this because now, when you look at the assembly, the actual instructions operated by the processor now needs to check to see whether or not this is the first time we've called this method. Because if it is the first time, then we need to allocate this memory. If it's not, then we can just get the pointer to the where that was allocated, and we can just use that, and we're all good. If we don't do that, then there's no checks that need to happen. It just allocates 13 bytes, which is very, very quick on the stack. It just moves the stack pointer. Very, very easy operation. Whereas making this static, we make it persistent, but now we need to do a bit of checking. So if you're doing this in a fast loop over and over again, yeah, that could get heavy. The way you want to think about it, though, is with coding, is make something that works and then optimize it. Always have in your back of your head, try and do it the best you possibly can, but don't try and over-engineer it and over-optimize it on the first pass. We will come back to this and we'll go, right, is there now a better way of doing this? Can we make it a bit better? Do we need to make it a bit better? Is it worth my time? But for now, let's just make it static. I wouldn't necessarily recommend this as good practice, by the way. But yeah. How long are we on? 1 hour. Right, okay, cool. This is when we're not even going to get any Wi-Fi done today. I'll tell you what we will do though. So let's just talk through this. We're statically allocating this buffer. Technically, we don't need this anymore, because smprintf is going to take care of that, but we'll do it. That sort of is good practice to initialize it. We're allocating a temporary byte buffer that is not static because we don't care about it when we leave this function. We're going to get those bytes that represent the MAC address. We're going to convert them into an ASCII string of hex, and then we are going to return the pointer to this string that we've just created. That is not going to be destroyed when we leave this function, this method. And that will do what it will do. And that will work perfectly fine. So let's not start on any Wi-Fi stuff now, because I do want to not make these videos too long, and I'm starting to fatigue anyway. But let's do that optimization pass now. Typically, I wouldn't do it this early on, but let's do it now while we're sort of on it. Let's think about the bigger picture here. Each time some user of our Wi-Fi component wants to get the MAC address, it's having to check whether or not it's the first call. Then it's going to have to allocate some memory on the stack. Okay, that's a very quick call. It's having to call this function Don't know how heavy that is. That might be quite a heavy function. I'm not even going to bother F12ing into it. Chances are it's just reading some very easily accessible memory, so that's probably quite cheap anyway, but in this instance, but might not be. We're not actually doing anything with this return type, so if this doesn't return good data, there could be anything in this byte buffer, but we're still going ahead and trying to populate it, and these could be rubbish. If this doesn't succeed, returns an error, then we could just be returning to the user saying, this is your MAC address. Actually, it might not be. It might be just some random data that is wrong because this function failed. And then we're populating that, converting it into an ASCII string, and then returning that pointer here. Every single time we want to get the MAC address. Is there a better way? I'd say yes. Is it worth doing it the better way? Probably not. This works, but if you want to follow best practice, and if you think you want to learn, or you think it's going to make a difference, then let's see how we can do this. Think about it high level. What are we trying to get? The MAC address. Does the MAC address ever change? No, that's the whole point. Okay, so we only ever need to read this once and create this string once because this is never going to change on the ESP. It can, but it's you have to deliberately change it. But that's, it's not the point of a MAC address. So let's assume it's never going to change and we're never going to want to change it. There'd be no reason to for our project here. So all of this just needs to happen once. Okay. Do we need to do this every time and check whether it's the first call? Well, no, because if it's only ever been done once, then we just do it once. Yeah? So how do we persist this? Quite easy, actually. We can make it a class member. So back to our header, we're going to have a, in fact, let's make it private. A char, which is going to be our MAC address as an ask, let's just call it a string, C string. And it's an array. It's an array we already know is 13 bytes long. So this memory is going to be created when this class gets created. Okay. No matter how many times we create this class, the MAC address is always going to be the same. So we might as well make this static because it's the same for every single instance of the class. Now, in doing that, we need to statically initialize it. And this might look a bit weird. Oops. And that's how we statically initialize it here. And if I just save that file, IntelliSense should kick in. Is it gonna? That doesn't even need to be there because it's in the definition. Static char, byte buffer there. Oh, IntelliSense is crapping itself. Not quite sure why. Yeah, why is it doing that? Hang on, I'm just double checking, make sure I've written it right. Yeah, I have. We don't need to tell it how big it is, just that it is an array, because it's going to look for the definition and it goes, oh, it's 13, so that's fine. We can be naughty there. And it also means that if we do need to change this later down the line, we only need to change it in one place, because this will just get automatically deduced. and we're initializing it all to zeros. When the first instance of this class gets created, still has issues, but it's better. In fact, actually, let's call that Macadra string, just be a bit more verbose here. So we're not adding a string here, it's an address string. So now we don't need this. Still need this, we still need this, and in here we can do that. Let's just drop this down so you can see it. Something like that. It's not how I normally indent my code, but anyway, we've been through this. And it is going to populate this byte buffer with the actual data. Now, we don't necessarily need to return a pointer to this because we've got it as a class member. But we could return something a little bit more interesting. And we could return the status of this call so we can see whether or not it was successful. We could also potentially do something here where we could say if ESP OK equals status, then do all of this. And I'm going to put braces on it just so we get the bracket colorizing stuff. There we go. So if this succeeds, then populate this with data. Otherwise, don't bother. And assuming that we've not called this already, then the not bother means that we're just going to get a null string of length 0 in our MAC address here. Easy to detect that something's gone wrong. Okay, we're adding some branching and so on and so forth, but remember, we're only calling this once. And it's not going to be the user that calls this. So let's just make that an underscore first, which is sort of the way that programmers tend to use for you shouldn't be calling this. And then let's update our declaration here. And just to make it even more explicit that you shouldn't be calling this, we'll just make it private. So now how is the user going to get this string? So we need a public, and that's going to return the const char star get mac. It's a void, and I'm just going to do this in the class. It's going to return mac C string. And let's just drop that down the line so you can see. So now each time the user calls this, they're just going to immediately get this statically allocated byte buffer. String. Very, very quick. But it's just going to be full of zeros at the moment, of nulls. So it's not going to contain any useful data. So we're going to need to call this function once. Where can we do that? Well, let's just cheekily do it here in the constructor, which is going to take no parameters for the moment. So overriding the default constructor here. I have figured out why. Who spotted that earlier? Did anyone spot that? Yeah, there we go, IntelliSense has kicked in. And we are going to call underscore get mac. Now, we're not doing anything with this return type here. We could do, and we could do some logging on it. How could I do this easily? Let's show something really bad practice. and then I'm going to leave you on a cliffhanger. Oh, that was interesting. If ESPOK is not equal to get Mac, call abort, which will just reboot the processor. Because if we didn't get the MAC address, something's gone wrong somewhere. This is not what you should do. A couple of reasons. One, this constructor will be called every single time an instance of this class is created. We only ever want to do this on the first instance. It doesn't matter if we call it every time, but there's no need to. Because it's static, it's not going to change. So, how could we do this only on the first time one of these classes is constructed? And how can we do something a little bit more useful than just hard aborting and restarting the processor? Because that is just not helpful in the slightest, clearly. What could we do? Could we put it in a loop? Try again a few times. If not, then call abort. Log message. What do you think? A bit of audience participation. So there we go. That is getting a MAC address. Next episode, we'll start fleshing out the rest of the Wi-Fi stuff. Because now I've talked a bit about best practices and the way we're going to do things, and you're getting a feel for the way I code, we can start accelerating the pace a little bit. As always, any questions, so on and so forth, down below. I read everything because I'm not a big channel and I'm doing this because I want to. So, any questions, read down below. Have a look on Reddit as well, the subreddit ESP32. I've just posted a link to this series on there. Feel free to ask any questions. Very active community. Good bunch of troops on there. Let's take it from there. See how we go. Thank you very much for watching, and we'll see you on the next one.